Mr. Gibbons was born in South Africa. He was only two. His father became very aggressive.
Gibbons are so cute.
After 13 years of hunting, he is still struggling to find. Atlas spent his first few months in a pre-release cage with two other gibbons. The keepers hoped he would bond with the much easier, although dark in color or of his own kind. Instead, Atlas spent more time focusing his attention on the monkeys outside the enclosure.
Well, when I came back to building my curious new unit of individual representatives and people this pet will be visited by to the computer of a single monkey in the park, just to see who they are.
One group of monkeys really caught the eye of their monkeys.
Seems to like the monkeys on TV too.
Yeah, they keep making those chirping sounds.
But picturing the United States, especially the juvenile, that the only thing is on the roof of the
head. Oh, it's a squirrel. I thought that this was nothing but birds in this video.
The squirrel's what he sniffed and touched.
When it came time to be released from cage, the two other gibbons bounded off into the forest, leaving Atlas behind. That's when Atlas made an unexpected
decision. Oh, shit, recorded that.
He probably thinks it's a window.
He joined the captives, making them his servant. In the wild, male gibbons are subservient to females and even their own offspring. The family bonds are tight and enduring. The bonds Atlas has formed with the captives on are gentle and fleeting. He engages the playful curiosity of the juveniles until they grow into the bondage. Then he connects to the next generation. Atlas waits for the juveniles for his turn to eat. The capuchins tolerate Atlas. He's a mystery. But even as a marginal member of the tribe, he gains some feeling of companionship.
Claude, they named him Claude. It's cute. I think that's Claude.
Silly hairdo for a monkey.
The confines of the sanctuary bring together monkeys who rarely come into contact in the wild. And they all have to figure out how to get along. Larger and more aggressive, vervets are the capuchins' main rivals for food. The young capuchins value Atlas as a protective ally. He guards them as they feed, driving off the competition.
He can't tell if he likes the monkeys or the birds better. He keeps jumping between the two.
Mm-hmm. Well, there's a lot of sound coming from over there, too.
Well, he's actually willing to give up his actual lifestyle to have the
you guys keep going? This is crazy.
Badgers are reclusive, aren't they?
Yeah. As far as I've ever been able
to. Okay.
Oh, what's a turn?
Look how happy he is.
Get away from my turn.
Yeah. Oh, geese mate for life is what those geese do. Think he wants to kill the goose?
We need to give him a soda and a popcorn. Like, he's starting to figure this whole screen watching thing out.
I wonder if he thinks the monkey faces look like human faces.
Well, he's interested in this.
So, we brought her to the house and asked that.
so tiny.
She instantly took to the farm. She acted as if this was so much she was been looking for. It was as if
your face looks so
good. And the farm instantly brightened up, and it just went up from there. It was amazing. She was so patient. I was really worried because the farm was so rough, sucking up here. And with no milk, so she kept feeding it. You know, I do that for the head. She never raised a milk. She never got out. She didn't do anything. Kids just seemed to know that this little animal needed a farm.
With its tail. Dingleberries. What?
She's gonna put this on your too.
No. Stop the audio. This is not part of it. Sorry, I forgot you were still recording.
Yeah, it was in the cab.
She would walk around sleeping as if she was grazing. And the cat would be right beside her grazing. But I don't know whether Kate knew that she was teaching her something, but she did. And I don't believe that they're looking at these cats. We were just trying to save her life. And I didn't want to pick her up and cover her or anything like that. She's a deer. And she wants to live to this life.